Well, I don't know what's out there either.
Snug?
Could be. Oh, hey. Welcome to the Nerdy Photographer Podcast. I'm your host, Casey Fatchett. If you haven't listened to the show before, in addition to sharing entertaining and informative photography and business-related content, I also go on some nerdy sci-fi adventures with the crew of the starship Fibonacci. Right now, Golden Hauer and I are supposed to be exploring the surface of the planet we just landed on, but it seems he's a little worried about venturing into the unknown. And speaking of venturing into the unknown, on this episode of the Nerdy Photographer Podcast, I'm talking to Brooklyn-based photographer Kamal X about his new photo book, Black Astronaut, which saw him journeying around the country during the pandemic to document life and protest in a world unlike anything any of us had known before. It's a great conversation, so be sure to stay tuned for that after the break. Also, while you're here, you should be sure to subscribe, leave a review, and share the show with your friends. So, anyway, Golden, what is it that you're afraid of exactly?
Snug.
Oh, well, you can bring your own snacks, you know. Are you ready to take your website design to the next level? Look no further than Elementor, the cutting-edge WordPress website builder designed for professionals like you. With Elementor, you have the power to create entire website themes and layouts that are as unique as your imagination. Say goodbye to rigid templates and constraints. Elementor empowers you to design custom headers, footers, pages, posts, archive pages, and even WooCommerce product pages, all from a single user-friendly platform. The best part? You don't need to be a coding wizard to use Elementor. Say farewell to the days of wrestling with complex code or being dependent on a myriad of plugins. Elementor offers you a seamless, code-free design experience that puts you in control. So why limit your creativity? Choose Elementor and unleash your website design potential. Elevate your online presence with a website that truly represents your vision and brand. Get started with Elementor today. Just go to nerdyphotographer.com/recommends/Elementor and witness the transformation of your WordPress web design experience. It's time to build an extraordinary website with ease and finesse. Don't wait. Create with Elementor. Hello and welcome to the Nerdy Photographer Podcast. I am your host, Casey Fatchett. And in this episode, I'm here with Kamal X, who has got a new photo book out called Black Astronaut. Before we get into that, though, we're going to start off with the dice breaker, which is a little icebreaker we do here on the show. It's a 7. All right. Kamal, thank you for being on the show, first of all. I should have said that before. But the question is, what is the worst piece of photography advice you've ever received?
Ooh, okay. Worst piece of photography advice I've ever received. Make sure you get the most up-to-date camera. I think that was in the beginning, and I guess it was someone that probably wasn't really a professional. And they were just like, yeah, make sure you got all the bells and whistles, man. You just want to be prepared for where the world is going. And it had nothing to do with the art of photography itself. So I think that was probably the worst advice I've gotten, for sure.
Yeah, I would definitely not recommend that. My recommendation whenever people ask me about gear, and like, I'm starting out, I'm like, invest in good glass.
Yeah,
lenses are going to last you a lot longer than a camera is. Yeah, like if you decide on a system, just go with those, get good lenses.
I remember when I first started, that was actually with everyone, but that was basically the advice I got: get good glass. And I didn't even know what that meant, so it was like, glass, what are you talking about, glass? And I had to act like I knew, because I didn't want to look, but I was like, oh, they're talking about lenses, glass. Oh, okay. So it was a lot of the terminology is like a learning curve for me in the beginning. But yeah, glass is definitely great.
Yeah,
that's a great investment for sure.
I didn't at first, and then they learned that lesson a few years in, and then like I've still got some lenses that I bought, you know, a long time ago that still work great. That's why I always consider that good advice for people. So the book, first of all, I gotta say, just when you sent me the information originally, the title Black Astronaut hit with me. Obviously we're coming from different places in the world, but like for me, it evoked a lot of things. First of all, like exploration, the unknown, just being I was a huge like fan of NASA as a kid. So like just like places, you know, like, but also there aren't a lot of black astronauts. So definitely that also not immediately set my mind up for like, this is like going places that, you know, haven't been before. What was the process for you in coming up with the title and how that, and of this project?
Well, first, thank you again. Thank you for having me. I'm really thankful to be here. I love your show. I love the vibe, and I'm happy to share this moment with you. In terms of Black Astronaut and how it started, you know, similar to what you're saying, like, you know, exploration is the word I'm looking for. Going into the unknown, pushing yourself, being a person on a mission, you know, and defying odds, you know, like I love sci-fi movies. Yeah. That's my favorite genre. And I just, as I was taking those photos, because this photo book, Black Astronaut, is based on, you know, everything from 2020, George Floyd, pandemic, you know, the presidential issues, the vaccine issue. It's everything that America has been facing for the last 3 years, basically,
which
that
is
I was
a lot.
Documenting. And it, you know, it took a lot out of me. Like I was risking it all, especially in the beginning of the pandemic where we didn't have a vaccine. We didn't know how dangerous it was. And, you know, I remember getting on flights that were empty, you know, going to hotels, and it's like having air purifiers in the rooms because you just, that seemed like a dangerous place to be because people were, you don't know who's in the rooms and all this other stuff. And it felt like I was like journeying into outer space, you know. And then when the climate of America being like flipped upside down and me going outside and actually taking those photos and not recognizing America as I thought it would be, you know, and especially, well, in addition to what I saw on like CNN and just social media, you know, what I saw in real life was a lot different from that image or the imagery that I saw. So I just felt like I was really in the unknown for real. And I knew I had this like need or this intention to follow through. I didn't want to like go half-assed at it. I didn't want to just do like, okay, wait to the, you know, the verdict or get like a couple months and then stop. I was like, no, I want to really investigate this and go as far as this goes. Cause I feel like beyond the America element of it, which is very, very important. It also is a co-created space with my experience in this too. Cause I'm experiencing COVID. Right. I'm experiencing Black Lives Matter, the vaccine, all this stuff is also a part of my story. So that's where I wanted the book to kind of evolve past just the telling of what was going on outside, but make it also a personal experience of me, the Black Astronaut, you know? So it kind of like in a cool way, like bridges the gaps of everything going on and like gives it a different twist than other books that may have came out or in the past in terms of that type of content. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you're really totally immersed in it. And I think that that's really like just from, and we'll get into this a little bit more later, but like looking at the visuals, there's sort of this, like there's difference between like, there's what is like the experience for you as well as like, you know, what's happening in front of your lens as well. So what was the, okay, so I agree. Don't half-ass anything. And like my question based on what you just said, when was the turning point for you that made you decide like, okay, I am going to go out there. I'm going to go out there. I'm going to get on these flights. I'm going to go to these places and start taking pictures. I'm not just going to stay at home.
It kind of was like a preliminary kind of vibe. So the one thing about the way I shoot, which is I'm really happy I figured this out because it helps me tremendously, is I actually visualize before I shoot. So like I'll like write notes about what I'm trying to take pictures of. I'll even draw certain scenes of what I hope to see when I go out there. So that started with this project, honestly, because with Black Astronaut, I remember before 2020 hit and all other stuff happened, I remember like learning more about photography, like looking into like people that have done it before me and just seeing a lot of books that really reached me, which was a lot to do with the civil rights movement. So for instance, like the Million Man March, like in my mind, I'm like, man, I wish I could have took those photos. Like, is America ever going to have a moment in time like that, you know, and as a photographer to be, you know, able to witness these things and document them and be a part of history. You know, I was envious of that. I'm happy things are better or shifted since then. But at the same time, I'm like, when am I going to get my opportunity to kind of be outside and take those photos? So I already was kind of, you know, in my mind thinking this is what I want to do. You know, I hope if I get that opportunity, I'm not going to play with it, basically. And so when 2020 hit, and more so when we saw that video of George Floyd, it like ignited something in me. And it just was like, I knew once I left my apartment in Oakland, there it couldn't be, like I said, half-assed. I knew that I had to go all the way because of what I saw other people do in the past, like other books that have been successful series and photographers that have, you know, recorded very difficult times, even like photographers outside of America that maybe things like in Iraq. I saw this one book, it's called The War Photographer. I think his name is John someone with the N. And he has a documentary called War Photographer. And that documentary really, really inspired me because I saw it right before everything happened in 2020. Also, and I'm seeing this man out there taking pictures while people are shooting guns at war. I'm like, I'm not going to do that. But it's dope to see that level of, you know, taking your job seriously and putting it all out there. So when my number was called, so to speak, it was like, yeah, I can't, you got to go all the way if you really want to do this. Right. And I think that's a big reason why when, you know, seeing that video of George Floyd, it was like, it just clicked. It was like, you know, you got to go around the world, man, not a world, America. You're going to have to do it. It was scary too. I'm not going to lie. Get on that plane. I was wiping everything down. I was like, please sit me as far away from everybody as possible. But after a while, I did build my confidence with that, because after like a couple of, especially the plane thing and being okay, you know, I was just like, okay, like, you know, because you can't let it debilitate you to the point when you got to work, you're not working the way you need to work, you know? Yeah. So you kind of have to like turn that off. The fear has to go, and you just got to like really be there, you know?
Yeah. And it's just, I think like you said, you build more confidence with conflict photographers, like people who are in wars and wars. Like I have the utmost respect for, like there's some other documentaries and things that I'll recommend to you after we get done, but there's like some amazing stuff out there that, yeah, I can see why that it put you on that turn. Also, yeah, you mentioned like the civil rights movement, and I'm like, where's my thing to photograph? And you know, yeah, it's like it's a curse though. It's like those, like, may you live in interesting times, you know. Yeah. There's just the, like, do you really want this to be going on?
Be careful what you wish for,
right?
Because things, yeah, it's still going down, obviously, you know, in so many ways.
That 2020 bingo card got filled up real fast.
Oh yeah man. So, you know, that's a lesson learned in a lot of ways too, you know. And I think that, you know, as a photographer, I will say, like, now that, you know, that's, I'm the book's out, thankfully. I'm proud of it. I'm excited. I'm happy people are able to engage with the content now and like have conversations and dialogue, which is what I really was pushing for. But I also learned in terms of moving forward is like, you know, just be patient and be willing and able, you know, because it might not be another 2020, which I hope we never experience again, but never like sleep on the stories that may, you know, show themselves to you. Don't ever like treat it as like, oh man, I wish I had those moments. Like, realize that as you're alive now, there's something going on that's interesting. There's a story to find. It's just a matter, are you willing to, let you know, put yourself out there and really find it?
Are you willing to look hard enough too? Like, yeah, things that are going on that you can tell a story about, like that. If you really wanted to make the effort, you can.
Exactly.
Are you just going to sit there and let it happen, or are you going to be part of the conversation?
Exactly.
So I guess, like, in the visuals that I've seen from the book, as I mentioned before, there's sort of like two, you've got like the very documentary reportage style stuff of like protests and other things going on. And then it's portraiture. And what kind of, I mean, I can gather a little bit, like, you're having other people try on this like astronaut outfit. And what is it that you're trying to convey via the portraits alongside these are the people who are, I'm asking a question, like, are these the people who you met along the journey? Like, what was what is it you're telling with
the vision that I'm trying to show? For me, it's putting a different lens, because like what's happening outside is what's happening outside. Like, that, I have no control over that. That's, you know, I'm a photographer, so I am creating the images, but, you know, it's a co-creative space of what's happening outside. I can only do but so much. And I personally like having to balance that with something that's more direct, something that kind of gives me a little bit more control over what I want to say directly and kind of goes more into who I am as a person. And for me, a lot of the photos are representative of a certain things that I felt, you know, were difficulties that we were all facing, but at the same time, you know, we're still strong and we're still moving forward. So a lot of the photos is kind of like a aspirational, like looking to the future, being positive, being strong. Like, I think they're all women actually that have put on the suits. I'm the only person that's a guy. And I've just seen, you know, these are people that I personally seen just be very triumphant. I've seen like the picture with my friend Kristen. She has the two sons that have on astronaut outfits, and she's a single mom. And I seen her through the pandemic, like making it work, you know, like figuring it out, like getting things paid for and getting a new job and making sure they were okay. And I'm just like watching this from afar, like, wow, that's triumphant. That's powerful. You know, like doing the school, homeschooling and all that with two kids, you know, like making it happen. So I was like, yeah, let's do a photo shoot. And I wanted to find a way to symbolize your powerfulness as a woman, as a mother and a woman, you know. So that's an example for that. My other friend, her name is Punk Mega in my book, but you know, she has a nickname called Punk Mega. She has a one of my favorite pictures of the book, and it has the background that says, don't be a slave to the algorithm. And during the pandemic, we had a lot of talks about, you know, the phone and social media, social engineering, and, you know, being free and, you know, just thinking for yourself. And I'm like, all right, let's do something, you know, let's say something about the algorithms and let's find a way. So it's my kind of way to like nudge the conversation and give a little piece of me and, you know, create more conversation and dialogue.
It felt like this was where you were putting your, like, what's happens outside is exactly, it's what happens outside. This, the portraits felt more like, this is my take on what, how I feel about this and what I'm seeing and how like I'm experiencing and what's happening to me. Like, that's where I get to put my feelings and, you know, thing into this, not just like the creative process of creating the images, which you're doing outside as well, but like the portraits, especially, it's like, this is where I'm leading the conversation and not just witnessing it.
I appreciate you seeing it that way, because that's it, you know, and it's like, I try to do it in a way that I don't want it to be a distraction. I want it I want it to be abstract. I'm not going to lie. Because even me coming up with the concept Black Astronaut, to do, considering what the topic is, like, I am just that kind of a person. But, you know, trying to weave those things together is the challenge that I appreciate. So hearing you, you know, see and have that kind of, you know, reflection on it, I'm really thankful to hear that, because that is the goal. And I think I am one of those photographers that I really wanted you to know me. Like, I'm just, that's the kind of person I am. I've always been that way. So I just have to be honest and just be me. And, you know, I like it. I just put it that way.
Yeah, it's great, man. And also, you know, like being a single mom raising two kids during the pandemic, like that is as triumphant as going to space. That is as triumphant, you know, an accomplishment, you know, like I think that's really reflects like what you were trying to, the theme elevates all of this. And
definitely. And so, I remember when, oh, sorry.
No, that's right. Go ahead.
I remember when I was speaking with the publisher, when we were having dialogues about, you know, what direction to put the book and everything. And I remember, like, I was like, he was just asking questions to understand. It wasn't like he was questioning it as a bad thing. He was asking like the purpose of those images and what was the aim I was trying to go. And I was like, I know that we've just been through a lot of stuff. Like, this is tough times. It's not a book of just all glory and smiles. I get it. But I think it's important to have a positive outlook. It's important to show strength. It's important to show that we're trying to go somewhere in the future. And even though we have this baggage and these challenges, we can still become triumphant in the end. One of the first chapter in the book, I have this chapter called Forgiveness. And it's where I really, really kind of, the vulnerability is at its highest. I'm sharing a story that happened with me where I almost lost my life. And I tied that into, you know, forgiving the situation that I was put into, you know, and I put it there, and I got some pushback on that too. And I put it there because I wanted this book to really be an opportunity for us to grow, an opportunity for us to think bigger and move forward, even though we have all the right in the world to be angry. It's not saying that, you know, anger and rage is not a part of this conversation. But I do think it's important to remember that we have to live and continue to move forward and see a bigger picture, for sure.
Feel the feelings and then find where we fit in there and how we move forward from there. So my question to you as a photographer and author, like, what responsibilities do you think that artists have in reflecting and then influencing these conversations and changes in society?
Well, I think certain people, it's not for everybody. But I do think for those that feel that call or that push or that feeling, I think it can be scary. It can be intimidating. It can feel, especially if you're saying something that's not popular, so especially if you're saying something where maybe no one is seeing something that you're seeing. You know, sometimes we can get into the space of speaking on things that bother us because everybody else talking about it. So now it's okay, you know, but sometimes when it comes to artistry, often it's those that kind of put a highlight on something that people aren't seeing yet. So that can be a very intimidating thing. And that's why I say that's not for everybody, but I would press and implore people, if you have a vision or you see something that's missing in the painting, in terms of life, you know, if you feel something that you're experiencing that maybe isn't getting enough light, or you think it's something small, it might be something huge. It might be something that the world needs to see. And, you know, everyone has their decision to make on that. But I think it's important that we understand the power of our voices, and we don't like sleep on the possibility of impact. Because one of the things I've learned in life, you know, I remember growing up feeling like I didn't have a voice, feeling like no one, like I was just different and didn't fit into the paradigms or the visions of, you know, being successful. You know, I wasn't a lawyer, a doctor. I wasn't necessarily that great in school. I was the kid that was looking out the window, daydreaming all day, you know? So like there was a lot about me that made me feel like I don't know where I belong, you know? And once I got enough confidence and, you know, figured it out and found a route to just be okay, and I started sharing my story, I found more and more people were just like me. It's just that no one was speaking up. Right. You know, so it's like oftentimes you'll be surprised that a lot of people are facing what you're facing. It's just that somebody has to be the one to put it on Front Street and say, yo, this is what's happening.
Yeah. You know? It's one of those things that, like, if you don't talk about it, you don't, like, this is a generational thing too. And like, I am a little older than you, but not, I'm Gen X. And, you know, it's like being able to talk about what's going on is, you know, it feels like much more open now, especially than when I was growing up. People can have conversations about things. During the pandemic, I had like a lot of conversation with other photographers and creative people, and then it kind of like expanded to people outside of that, both through the podcast and through other like social media platforms about depression and mental health. It became such more of a priority because people like were sitting at home and like dealing with a lot of stress and anxiety and everything, just, and also just like it's depressing. You know, there's a lot going on, a lot of things that made people not feel good and all that sort of like weighing on people. And people were starting to like open up about like, hey, this is what's going on in my world.
Right.
And then that sort of sharing that feeling made people feel more people feel comfortable sharing it. And I think that I will say that I am a victim of the like, you know, whatever this thing that I'm going to talk about is not going to be like, people aren't going to listen to that or whatever. I often feel that way. And you like you just talking about it inspires me to be like, you know what? I'm going to get out and do that project where like I should write down those. Yeah. I have a whole list of ideas, but I should actually go and, you know, whole ass one of them instead of just reading about it on my list of things to do.
Do it, man. I hope you do. And I believe in you. And even if, and this is the other part of the conversation, you know, a lot of this isn't really tied to the success of it. Meaning like, okay, if you do that project, does it become, you know, whatever your vision for what you hope that to be? Sometimes the real gift is just the feeling of completing it and you liking it. in itself, that being the number one feeling, like you liked it. It was a great experience for you. You get to keep that gift, and hopefully, yeah, the world sees it and it becomes all those beautiful things. But I think as an artist, it's like, that's the real gift, is the journey of creation and loving that process and like just loving that part. Yeah.
I think that that's a problem that we, you know, currently societally deal with a lot with artistic endeavors, is that people feel the need. Mm-hmm. It's got to be monetized. It's got to make money. Yeah. If I'm not making money off of it, you know, why am I spending my time doing it? Instead of, you know, taking the time to develop things like, oh, I'm going to work on this project. Maybe it didn't turn out so great. Like maybe it didn't go where I wanted it to, but you know, it teaches me things and I accomplished something and it taught me something for the next time to like, it added to my toolbox for the next project and whatever I did. And then it grows and grows. You grow as an artist. It's like, I feel like there's a lot of people, especially people, you know, that I see like getting into things now, they're like, I got to have like a million followers as soon as I can. And I gotta, you know, get like all, like I gotta be trending and I gotta like all the other things. I gotta be, you know, making a ton of money as soon as possible, instead of sitting there and like thinking like, what is my signature? What is my style?
Right.
They're like trying to emulate just what they think is, you know, popular and going to get the most clicks and being a slave to the algorithm in that way. And like, what's going to get the most exposure for me? Like, well, how am I going to get the most views on Instagram or TikTok or whatever? Like, I got to play towards that instead of creating an art that is separate from just trying to pitch it to social media.
Exactly. And one of the things, you know, I think is important for people to think about is think of, say your idea pops, like it goes well, right? It's a success based on you trying to create something for the algorithm, right? Like you it's not really you being honest with what you really want to do. It's just you trying to hustle the game, basically, right? And for certain people, that they'll be completely happy with that, because maybe that's just, they just like the hustle and that's cool. But for a lot of us, I think the fear that I have, because I've experienced this, is when you have success in places that don't fit you. Like it isn't who you are, but you have success in it. And then you have this pressure now to be something you aren't. And you can't, normally it can't sustain, because it wasn't created on who you are. It was created, like if someone copies someone else's style, for example, and they get like some credit for that, but you always wonder, why didn't they do anything else? It's because they can't, because they were always copying. I think there's a real virtue in the slower process, in the honest process, and just being, starting where you are. And, you know, I was at a point, I was really big on that algorithm. I had a lot of friends that were like travel photographers and getting like deals and all that stuff. And I was really trying to make that happen. You know, I was just going crazy trying to figure out like, what's the way, you know? And then I had to really look at it though. I had to really look at what I saw in terms of their lifestyle, their happiness, in terms of, you know, their creativity, was it growing or dying? Was it, you know, and I really didn't see myself in that lifestyle. It didn't make sense to me. It seemed like it was more depressing than anything. It wasn't about the work at all. It was kind of about just appeasing other people and not really standing in your truth. And I just like stopped, and I just went into like not caring much about the algorithm and just doing what I wanted to do. I put a picture out. If they don't like it, oh, well, I like it, you know. And it's crazy that my career shifted so drastically the more and more I stopped caring about fitting into what social media deems as this is working or not, or trying to get brand deals and be popping and millions of followers. The further I went away, and that, the higher my actual career started to grow.
Right.
So I think sometimes, I think it is a co-creative space. You do need both to a degree, but I think sometimes we're too focused on that one side and we don't realize how much people in the real world, like, you know, through real connections and meeting real people in the industry and talking to galleries, going to galleries, speaking to people, meeting up with artists, doing what we're doing, talking with artists on, you know, podcasts in a real way. This is way more tangible and worth something versus, I think, just trying to get people you don't know to follow you.
Right.
You know, like
just throw it. I'm going to throw this on Instagram and see if I get 100,000 views on my reel. Yeah. Just like that's, I think that there's people try to fit the formula.
Yeah.
for success. They try to.
And that formula is a robot. That's a robot that's coming up with that formula, everyone. So you're trying to create something for people. Like, at the end of the day, you're creating something that you want people to feel. You want reaction. If you have an art show or something like that, you want to sit there with your art and talk to people, and they actually get something from it. But the deal maker, the middleman, is a machine that doesn't care about feelings.
Right.
So what I think starts to happen, and if you look at the art industry, you can kind of see this, it's dying down. Like, you're not, it's harder to find a good movie. It's harder to find good music. It's harder to find good art, you know, and I don't think that's just a coincidence. I think that's the middleman being a robot, and the robot isn't about emotion and connection. The robot is about what gets people to do this all day.
Yeah.
And that doesn't work in the real world with real feelings and connections. And yeah, it's very evident, I think.
It's one of those things that I find when we talk, again, generationally speaking, that my generation and other people, like, make fun of millennials or Gen Z when they're like, oh, we discovered this new movie, that's been around for like 30 years, whatever. I think it's partially because it's like, we found it. Like, well, you didn't find it for everybody. You found it for yourself. And like, I get that. It's like, you went outside the algorithm. You went out, you found something that was not fed to you by your Netflix feed or, your Pandora or Spotify, like auto, thing that just like determines you're going to like this because this is, you liked this music and you chose that. And so therefore you are going to enjoy this as well. And it's all the same thing. And then when you happen to like venture outside of that for a minute and like find some new thing, you're super excited about it. My thing is like, you didn't discover it. It's been around for 30 years. People watched it. It maybe won an Oscar. It may have like, won some Grammys or whatever. Like, people knew about it beforehand. But yeah, it's great. Congratulations on finding it and enjoying this thing that you normally wouldn't have found, because that's awesome. It's going to inspire you to do other things. It's just
that's
like,
funny.
I try to go against the algorithm a lot and like confuse it in some ways. Like, also,
you try to play with it.
Screw it up sometimes. Because my particular, like, especially when it comes to music, my musical tastes are all over the place. Cannot figure out, like, my wife. Well, I sit there, like, she'll like pull up my Spotify and just like, oh, your mix. And I'm like, you're not going to like that. Because for me, I love it. I can go from 90s hip hop to like 70s rock, to, like Taylor Swift, and I'm happy with that. And she's like, no, this just isn't we're like jumping over around too much. But
that was the issue in my last relationship. I'm similar to you. She just couldn't get with the. I'm just like, because I still make my own playlist, which I realize people don't do that any. Like, yeah, I still will manually make my playlist. That's
absolutely.
It's like,
I've got a ton of them for like different things, for like different moods. Like, I've got this one for like working out. I've got this one to just like get myself amped up on the way to a shoot. Like, I've got this one for like just chilling out and I got to relax, whatever. I've got like that. I've specifically chosen those songs, and occasionally I'll go back and be like, you know what? That one doesn't work anymore. I'm pulling it out.
Still critiquing it, moving things around. I'm just like you. We definitely have that in common for sure.
And then there's the road trip 100%. Mix that has just a conglomeration of everything.
Oh yeah. You from what you say you like, I think the playlist that I have that's similar to that is it's called Electric Soul Groove. No, Electric Soul Rave. So it's like a lot of like rock, but then I have like newer hip hop that's kind of rock inspired. And then I got lists like the straight up 90s hip hop in there. And then it's like all, a little bit of jazz, but that's like my road trip. That's like my day to day kind of like vibe out, get some new vibes in there. But I'm with you on this. I'm with you 100%.
So going back to the book, we'll get more into that stuff in a minute. I've got all sorts of questions. Was there a key moment during this creative process that was really like particularly impactful or challenging for you that like made you think like, okay, this is going to change,
honestly,
the look and feel of this project? Or
there was a few of those, honestly, even from the beginning when I was in Oakland, California. Oakland, if people don't know, that is like that for in terms of protests and standing up for you, that's it. They don't play. And I love the Bay for a lot of things, but that's one of the things I love them the most for. But if I'm being, there was a surprise I had Like, again, there's a lot of things that were pivotal moments, not going to lie. But there was a surprise. And it was when I went to D.C. And there was the I Have a Dream speech anniversary march. Mm-hmm. Right. And that was a great day of shooting, a hard day, an emotional day. It was everything. And it was like, I never worked that hard in my life. Like I literally almost had a heat stroke. Like literally, like my friends had to give me ice and Gatorades. I was working my ass off. And the thing it was the next day that was a surprise. So the next day there was a HBCU march. They did their own thing. I think it was Howard University and like another small, like a smaller school. They like kind of got together. So this is all college kids. Like I remember that they met on the campus. There was like a track they all met up. And I remember showing up and it was very quiet. There wasn't a lot of energy. It was like younger kids, like I guess Gen Z, I'm not sure. And I was just like, I don't know about this. And then I remember when the march started, like they started going and they were just like, the energy was low, nothing like I didn't feel moved by anything. So I'm just like, oh man, this is, you know, and then I started talking crap about the young kids and like, this is the problem with them. And I was really like judging them left and right. And then to my surprise, I think they just got alive for some reason. Like, I think it was because people started seeing them. And like they started going to the part around DC where there were people in restaurants. So people started standing up with their phones and stuff. And I guess this is just a part of the generation, phone thing. But it was also, it was so enlightening once I saw them show themselves. Like, it was like, I remember getting goosebumps and going like, what? Because I always deemed them as not being a lot going on creatively or, you know, I just don't know them that well. And what I was seeing from the outside looking in that moment was like proving my point. Like, this is what I'm talking about. Like, this is kind of boring. But then once they got comfortable, and I think they kind of allowed me in a little bit too. I think they got comfortable with me and started like even like doing a lot of stuff with me. Like they see me with the camera, they would walk towards me and start, you know, giving me vibes basically. And I remember it was just like one of the biggest surprises for me because it was a learning experience of just like opening my mind up. And it was like one of the most beautiful days for me because it was such a surprise. And the fact this is the younger group of people. Like everything I took photos of was like my age group and older, you know, like people that aren't in college pretty much. So right. This was college kids, you know, young adults showing their version of what they were feeling. And I got some of the greatest photos, I think, in the book on that day, in that moment. It was just it just gave me so much life and so much just admiration and reminded me of what it was like to be that young again. Like it just was. I remember when it was over, I called my friend in DC and I was like, I just had the craziest, dopest day ever. Like I just never, that kind of energy, that soul, that free spirit, that youth, you know, like to see it in full. Like I'm like, yo, the youth is just it's a beautiful thing to be young, especially they seem to be in their own way, you know, standing up for what they believe in a way that I just had to take my time to see it. So I think that was just one of the most amazing moments for me in that experience.
It's interesting how you pose that generationally. Again, like this is like how they're reacting to the camera in the sense that they've grown up with like phones pointed at them. And like they kind of come alive when the phone is pointed at them. Like, oh, you're recording me? Like, okay, now it's time to like...
Now it's time to go.
Turn it on.
Which was an interesting thing, but I chose to be non-judgmental in that. I was just like... You know, that's the way y'all roll, and that's how y'all roll. But it's good to see you, you know? It's right. Good to see you, you know?
But I think there's a part of that that's like, you know, are we... Like, I'm just trying to understand it. I'm not judging it. I'm like, I'm trying to understand, like, maybe there's an element of that, like, we're going to save our energy until we know there are people watching because we want this to get...
We want the world to
out
see.
There.
We want the thing. And that, and there's two sides to that, too, you know? Yeah. And I think... And that's the beautiful thing about art, you know, because it's a conversation. It's a conversation. There's photos in there. You know, there's so many photos. That's the one thing I... You know, thinking about the past, about when phones weren't a thing, I feel like as a photographer, you went around and no one had a phone in their hand. Like, you had so much more interesting things to find because people were actually living life. Like, they were doing stuff outside. You know, now it's the phone. Once you see the phone, it's like, okay, I can't do nothing with that. What can I do? Like, it's the last thing you want to see in a photo is someone with their phone. Like, you know, and it's a lot of photos I had to like learn how to figure that out too. Like there's some photos in there with that phone in there, and I just found a way to like make it work, but it's still kind of like,
what are they doing with it? Well, yeah, like, are you documenting? Or are you just looking at your phone? What are you doing? Like, and there's stories you can tell there, but yeah, man, like, I just recall like back when I started out as a photographer being like, okay, especially at events and stuff, you didn't have to worry about people being on their phones and like, and now it's just like, everybody is just staring at their phone. You go to a concert,
It's all you see. You can't even see the.
Why are you here?
And why? Who's looking at these videos again? Maybe they're going live. I don't know, but I know I don't ever look at those. Like I'm like, just put it down.
Watch the thing. Maybe my thing is like, maybe I take a 5-second clip and go like, hey, look where I am. And that's it. Yeah. Maybe. Exactly. That's it. Otherwise, I'm just like
quick and easy. But over and over and over again, especially if it's somebody you like, I need to dance. I need to vibe out.
Yeah, enjoy the show. Enjoy being there.
I think I do have an opinion on this.
Okay.
I think this is my. You heard it here first. I think that similar to the cigarette in terms of how that shifted over time when no one thought anything was wrong with it and then people would smoke on an airplane, it was just everywhere. And then they realized the negative impact on it. And then they made a whole campaign. And now it's a lot harder to find people that smoke cigarettes. You definitely can't smoke in public. You can't go, there's smoke-free buildings for Christ's sakes. Like, you know, like, and I think the same thing's going to happen with the phone. I think once the information comes out in terms of how much this is affecting the world and people's mind states, and we all know the people making money, just like the tobacco industry was making crazy money. And then society said, okay, we have to stop this though, you know? And I think, I hope anyway, I think something similar will happen where it's going to be like, you can't go to a restaurant with your phone. Can't go to the like shows. They're already doing that with comedy shows. Like you can't go to a comedy show. With certain comedy comedians will take your phone and give it back to you when it's over.
They put it
like
in
I think this will bag. We will see the impact on this in the society and be like, yo, we gotta. This isn't it. You know, I hope so.
Yeah, I mean, there's a certain amount of like. I hope that there's. I feel like there is. We're on the verge of a digital backlash.
Yeah.
I think that like. I've already and maybe it's like they're diverging paths. There are some people who are like, I'm totally fine with it. There are people who are like, nope. And these two branches of the river just keep growing further apart. But like the AI stuff, like with the AI art, like I saw like going one of two ways. People were just like, this obviously looks like AI and it is not good. Right. And also like, you know, there's all the ethical questions about using AI, but there's also like, there's a generation of people who are just like, I don't care. Take my photo, take my likeness and turn it into, you know, 80 different cartoon versions of me or whatever. And they're like, yeah, it's fine. Whatever. Like other people are like, no, don't do that to me.
They say that until someone actually literally does it and they see it in real time. And
they go,
you know, what? Like there's a line, you know, there's a line. I do like that so far AI doesn't seem to do anything that's dope in terms of visual and pictures anyway. I can tell that a mile away. I'm like,
no, there are some that I've seen that are more documentary looking that I will say the person, whoever is giving it the prompt is really good because they get really granular with like, there's going to be a reflection in the window, blah, blah, blah. And they do all this stuff and they create like really amazing stuff. And I'm just going, and I look at it and I go, that's problematic. Because it's like you can really like there's this never happened. Like I remember the first one I saw that I was kind of like, ooh, it was like Saint Francis dancing at a club. And now there's like you can see the quality has gotten worse, but there's like, you know, there's like everybody at like a metal singing at a metal concert. They had like Danny DeVito singing at a metal concert and Nicolas Cage and whatever. And like, but you can tell it's AI just because like the face looks wrong.
It's like sums up.
But this one was like Pope Francis dancing at a club. And I was looking at it and I looked at it and I'm like, this is really hard. Like if you didn't know this was fake, like you just immediately know it's fake.
Yeah.
But if you didn't know, you'd be like,
you're like, oh, this is real. Like if someone didn't know who that was or
real.
Oh, okay.
This looks, it looks real.
We'll see. And that might be the thing that, who knows? I just think something like you said, I think there will be a backlash coming sooner or later because it's you got to have some regulation.
I think you're going to have two sides to it. I just think that like there's going to be the people who are just like, I hope that much like the smoking and non-smoking, I'm a former smoker, But the thing is, like, you know, when I got to, I many times wanted to quit and like quit and quit and quit and quit and quit until eventually it took. And now it's been 6 years.
Congrats.
Thank you. I quit like 8 times. And just, which just goes to show you, I didn't really want to be smoking. But I was addicted to it. Mm-hmm. But like this, it's the same thing. I think it's going to be, these people are addicted to their phones.
Yeah.
People are addicted to their phones, and you're gonna have the people who are going to like, be like, no, we shouldn't do that. And I'm one of those people who would be love if it wasn't for work, which is the only reason I check my phone. And I have not been on social media for a while lately. Hey listeners, guess what? Yes, I'm still alive. But I have not been on social media a lot lately just because there's other things, like real life things going on. I'd be happy to put my phone down and walk away for like 3 hours from it and just like go to a show and not like have to think about my phone.
That's the one thing I love about photography, because that's, I never, once I'm in that zone, the phone doesn't exist anymore. Like it just, it's the furthest thing from me. I might look to see if I have to use a map or something like that, but even that, I get lost. I love to get lost with my camera. I just get curious and go. And I think that's like, I love that the phone is, it's just not a part of that creative space for me. Like, I'm so thankful for that, because, because once I get in that tunnel vision, I look for it. Like, the new project that I'm working on, it's like I'm gearing up to get really into it. Like, now I'm kind of, like, doing it, like, from here and there, because I'm still figuring some things out and I'm promoting the book. But, you know, once we're further along in this process, I'm definitely going to be, like, back to, like, tunnel vision. Phone is far away from me. I'm going a week just zoned out, 2 days off, back for a week, you know, like I can't wait for that. That's a part of my journey, my process, and I just love, because the phone, it messes up everything.
It causes problems. It gets between,
creatively speaking.
Yeah, well, not just creatively, but, just experiencing life. Like,
yeah, for sure.
I took my Halloween. It's because other reasons I'm thinking of Halloween, but my pandemic sort of thing that I picked up was hiking. And it's just like putting my phone away and going out in the woods with my dog, and just everything goes away. And I'm like not checking my phone. I'm not doing anything. Like it's that escape from the technological life. Both my,
it's like my a breath of fresh air. It's like, thank God. It's just, ooh, the real world. You know,
be here in this moment and not have to like think about what somebody else is doing somewhere else.
I'm
like
telling you, and that's why this, again, this art, man, I'm worried about art. Art has been, from my understanding of like researching it, it goes through ups and downs, though. It's not always at the forefront of humanity. It goes through its moments, and maybe that's what's happening too. I don't know, but I definitely, I'm concerned about the vibes, because I want more individuality. Individuality is really important to me, and I look for it. I get excited when I see it in someone else. I go, okay, that's something different. That's someone, you know, they got their own little twist. Or even if it's, I can just tell they're really connected to their work anyway. You know, like it's a personal thing for them, and that's inspiring to see and witness and support, you know. And I just find it harder to kind of, it just seems like everybody's out here hustling, not creating, you know?
And not encouraging you to be somebody different, because there's a lot of other people who are out there saying like, hey, come do my thing that I, I'm there, because they're just trying to sell something. They're trying to sell their scheme for something, because they're trying to monetize whatever. It's like that's their hustle, as opposed to saying like, hey, you know what, be yourself. It's like, find out, figure, and you know what, that might take some time. It's not going to happen overnight. Like, you're not just going to go home and like sit around for one night and decide who you are. Done, man. I spent 2 hours.
I remember I did this podcast back in the day. I had one called We Are the Light podcast, and someone was a guest, and we were talking about like the question of who am I and how do you get to it. I remember someone was like, just be, and I was like, just be. What does that mean? I was like, what are you talking about? I was like, just be. I'm like, be what? You got to give me a little bit more instruction on that. That just sounds like, that sounds like nothing to me. That's like saying I'm like calling yourself a photographer, but you've never even taken a picture before. Like, what does it mean to be? Like, what is it? That's just an example of like, you know, that made me think about
that. I have something on that though. That to me is more of a kind of a Zen approach to it. And just being like, instead of like trying to put some sort of label on it, or make it a thing, just do your thing. Like that, I think that that's where, I'm not sure that that's what the person meant, but to me, when somebody says like, see, just be,
you're coming from it from a person that your answer wouldn't have been just be. So you're, right. you're able to, so put this person is not, if you saw the whole, you
okay.
know,
yeah, like I'm getting like, a sense from you that that's not what that person was intending.
Yeah.
That was not,
I was trying to get her to do what you just said. That's what I was hoping for, the answer. I knew what she was, but it's just, you know, I think it's important to investigate some things and like really see what people mean, you know?
Yeah, it's like, and if you're sitting there trying to make it fit into the square, like it's what I find funny is like the same time that people will be like, I just want to be myself, but at the same time they're doing it like in the format of like the popular way to get this out there. Like if you don't care like what people think, then you don't care what people think, and like in somebody who's, you know, been doing this for a really long time and spent a lot of years like trying to make other people happy and did not make themselves happy. And I found that I've made myself way more happy by doing the things that I like and not caring what other people thought. Not like paying clients. I have clients that pay. I got to be concerned about what they think or else I'm not going to get more paying clients.
Right. Exactly.
There's a, you got to balance on that one.
You got to play the game.
Yeah.
You got to play the game.
So what, like when you talk about, in, you know, seeing other people's work and like how it inspires you, what are the key takeaways or lessons that you hope people who see your work get, what, like from engaging with photos? What do you want people to get out of that?
I think I just honestly, like, I'm just for reflection and conversation. Like that's like my hope, is that it just opens up a space that allows you to have dialogues with yourself and ask yourself questions about, you know, the purpose of life, why we're here, the emotionality that comes with life that oftentimes, you know, we don't necessarily know how to navigate. You know, a lot of my photography, I try to, you know, go into the more emotional space. I look for a mood and vibe because, you know, that's kind of the way I like to communicate and see the world. And I find when I find like raw emotion or things that kind of evoke that out of me, I get inspired, you know, because I think it's, the way it's difficult to understand emotions in general, you know, because if you think about it, like words are kind of like not enough to really describe half the stuff we feel. You know, we could say anger, but does that really define what you may be feeling, or I love you? Like, what does that even mean to you versus what that can mean to someone else? You know, these words sometimes don't necessarily encapsulate what we are. So I hope that my photography kind of inspires people to just go on emotional journeys and ask more questions and kind of just see how things make you feel and just see the world in a new way, or just be more open to what's happening around you, like, and see that there's more going on than what you think. Sometimes what you see, the picture you see, there's more to it, you know?
There are different levels to things, and other people might be experiencing something similar, but not the same as you. I think that's one of the empathy is a trait that would be really helpful for a lot of people to learn. But yeah, I think that's a reflection is that's a great purpose. So I want to ask, like, what advice, like, because I'm somebody who struggles with this. As I mentioned, I've got a list of ideas for things, but sometimes I have trouble following through because I'm an Aries. And I just like have a lot of like, I'm an idea man, and following through is not always my strongest suit. But what is your advice to people who are thinking like, I want to do something, I have the idea, and like seeing it through to fruition? What is your advice?
There's a couple of things, but first write it down and make it, put it somewhere visible. Like, if it's a vision board, or if it's just I'm really a big fan of white chalkboards and writing goals down like weekly. Sometimes I have stuff that's like there for longer periods of time. And then I have like another section for like day-to-day goals or weekly goals. And don't make it so like crazy that it's like, oh my God, how am I going to do all this? But like, think in small pieces, like, and that's the other part, like start where you are, pick something that you could actually do. There's this therapist that I follow online. I can't think of his name right now, but he was talking about depression, and someone was like trying to tell him about, you know, when people are depressed, you know, they don't want to do this and they got to do that. They got to do that. And he's like, this person's an actual therapist. He's like, actually, that's not true. Actually, what a lot of times you find, it's about finding the small thing someone can do. For some people, that's even getting out of the bed.
Right.
Getting out of the bed is a triumph. And I, when he said that, I was like, wow, that's so real and deep and relatable and true. And I could tell he actually does the work, because that's not what that other guy is talking about.
Right.
And I look at it similar to like a dream or a vision or a goal. It's like, some people, yeah, they can go get a big thing overnight and like they got this big plan. But for some people, just write it down, put it on a board, and then pick something else small. Go right. Get the equipment you might need. Find locations that you can start shooting. Find a friend that you can do a photo shoot with to just, you know, get some sample images and then see if you like what's going on, or if it's not working, or you got to go buy some clothes if you're going to a look, you know, whatever, go to a gallery that's something in this category, get a book that is similar to what you're trying to do so you can do some homework and like, you know, learn some more of the game. Like there's so many smaller things that are really big pieces, or they can be small things that build up to a big piece. And yeah, that's kind of, it can seem so overwhelming, because I remember like years ago, I said I was going to put a book out. I was like, I'm going to get published. I wanted to be published around the world, like, and that just sound crazy. And, you know, to get to where I'm at today, where this is literally the reality, my book came out 2 days ago and it's like a worldwide release, which is like, I'm in a dream and it doesn't even make sense right now. I know the route to getting there was a lot of small pieces, a lot of like working hard and diligently about these things that seem like they're not a part of that big picture, but you kind of need to build your momentum. You need to build your knowledge. You need to build your work ethic, honestly. So when the opportunity shows itself, you're prepared and you can like over deliver.
Yeah.
You know, because I've seen some people get like put up to the front of the line, but they didn't do all the small parts to get themselves prepared. And then they drop the ball, or they don't get another opportunity again because they didn't do all those small pieces to build themselves up to be able to handle the call,
the big,
when it comes.
Yeah, when the big,
you know,
call comes down at the end. It's what I refer to as digestible chunks. Like,
yeah,
and whether it's art, work, whatever the case may be, like just your personal life, finding those digestible chunks of things that you can manage to do. Like I said, just getting out of bed, that's a digestible chunk that you can, you're not going to try to eat the whole meal in one bite.
Because like, you're just not going to, if you say you want to lose 100 pounds, and like you got, let's lose 5 first. Let's lose 2.
Right.
Let's work on the meal plan.
Let's break it down into little pieces.
Juice away and soda away. Yeah. You know, like, so same thing with photography. Well, any goal, I would say, yeah, write it down what you want to do, and then put in layers to things that you can do to build up to that point, and hold yourself accountable. Hold it accountable. Don't just talk about it to friends. Please, God, don't just tell everybody about what you're going to do. You got this, because that can be a sense of it's like a, it's not delusion, but it's a sense of like you feel like you're doing it because you're getting some. They're saying, oh, wow, that's great, but you didn't do it yet. You know, like, so maybe if you're in it and you're sharing with people what you're actually doing. But it, maybe that might be funny, too, because they might not understand what your goal is, you know, so like, don't get too caught up in the reaction of friends and family as you're going towards your goals.
Yeah, you need to you need to be honest with yourself, or you need somebody who's going to be honest with you and it doesn't have a vested interest in
100%.
This. It's going to give you honest feedback. I mean, like I always tell people when they're asking, like I occasionally coach people on their businesses and stuff sometimes if they come to me and ask for help. But one of the things I tell people is every year, set up some goals each year. And some of them have to be easily accomplishable. Some of them in that medium range that you're probably going to get to. And some that you're going to have to really stretch to get to, because you get the satisfaction of accomplishing those easy things. You're most likely going to hit that stuff in the middle, and you're always going to be striving to get the ones at the end. And you need to check in with yourself regularly. Well, that's one of the things I said, like you write it down, those big things, you break them down into smaller chunks that you can get to, like, Where do I need to be every 3 months to get to that place at the end of the year to have that done? Because I had somebody who was like, I want to book, you know, 40 weddings a year. And I'm like, well, there's a lot of things that go into that. Like there's a lot. It's not just like, I'm going to do that. And then like, let's see if it happens at the end of the year. Like, no, you need to, you know, here's what you should be doing. Like, you should be kind of on a schedule. Mm-hmm. Like, where are you in your place of like getting those? when are you most likely to, like, what do you need to do marketing wise, or what do you need to do, you know, social media wise, or these things, all these things that kind of come together that you need to be doing that are smaller pieces that make the greater whole.
100%.
All right. So now I got a question. Like, what's your favorite sci-fi film? I'm just curious, because you mentioned this at the beginning, like you're a big science fiction fan. Or you can, it doesn't have to be the favorite, be top, space, three. Top three.
It might be Space Odyssey. Space Odyssey is one. No order in this.
Okay.
So Space Odyssey. Am I going to say Aliens? I think I'm going to say Aliens.
Mm.
I think Aliens. I really like Aliens. See, it's so many. Oh, geez.
Once you open that.
It's because now I'm thinking of like Star Wars.
I consider Star Wars fantasy more than science fiction.
Okay, I got you. Okay, that helps me. Okay, so let's see. And the last one, it's a newer one. And I'm thinking, and I hope I don't forget the ones that are like really on top. I hope these are the ones, but I think Interstellar did something that was that was something else. So Space Odyssey, Interstellar, and Aliens, if I'm thinking. I really vibe with those.
Love those choices. Obviously, if anybody who's listened to the show, like the story that I put around everything, like, knows all those things have had an influence on the stories I've told outside of the actual interviews. Especially Space Odyssey. Hal is one of my favorite characters in science fiction of all time, which I always thought was interesting that his, Kubrick took that, like, just one letter off of IBM. H-A-L. Listen,
that movie, I just got goosebumps. Kubrick is... he's on my vision board, honestly.
And great photographer.
He started out with the photography. And to be honest, there's a part in the book that is kind of inspired by him. I chose to go an abstract route. And there's two sections in the book. It's deep space and antimatter. And that's kind of going into, it has seemingly nothing to do with protests, presidential campaign, George Floyd. And then I have this part, this like section in the book that's like about like what was going on outside with the nightlife, people that were like, didn't care about masks, didn't care about vaccination cards, going into like basements and partying. So I went into that scene, which I think was a important part. And then also, women's rights. There was the Asian hate situation that was going on. And a couple other things that were going on, birth control. Women's right. So I put that in there. And I remember the conversation I was having with one of my friends about it. And they were like, I don't know, that just seems so far off. And I was just being honest. I was like, when I look at like the work of Stanley Kubrick, like, and I look at like how he seemingly puts things together and just like makes you think, and you kind of have to like figure it out. And it just stands the test of time. Oh. Like, not that I'm copying it, but like, I wanted to kind of explore just doing different things based on the inspiration that I've gotten from him.
Oh yeah.
Like, I just was like,
I totally get that too. I totally get what you're saying. Like, but it also, it's not that those things are totally unrelated. They happened in the same time period.
Yeah.
It's sort of like,
definitely.
Yeah, to me, just hearing you say that, like that's part of the book, makes me go like, yeah, that would probably be kind of like, also like, I'm getting emotionally invested in this story you're telling. And then I'm like hit with all of these other things going like, oh yeah, that was all happening too. Oh man. Like, it actually deepens I don't know. There was a lot of feelings there. Like, every time something new would come up and we'd just be like, sort of like, okay. And now, people and now we're getting rid of women's reproductive rights.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
And you're just like,
well, guess I get my camera again. Go back.
Yeah, exactly. Like, here we go again. Right. I was waiting for something interesting to happen, and the universe keeps rolling sevens.
And I definitely too, and I never talked about this yet anyway, but like, I felt like it was important to give, like, again, the voices thing, giving people a voice and opportunity to get their, their message out there. And I was like, this is important. Like, it's not. And one of the things that I've seen in some of the other books that have come out that were based on the same time period, I think that they put them out too quickly. I think they just focused on the protests and didn't get the whole story. And it's like, it wasn't over yet. Like it still right. technically isn't over, you know? Yeah. And I think that's one of the things I'm proud about, that I didn't shoot the gun and just go, okay, gun, put it in. Let's
go. Got it done. It's like, no,
there's way more to this story. And I'm happy I took my time with that.
You let it percolate.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
Hello there, Nerdy Photographer listeners. Do you have a website or do you need one? Let me tell you, you should be using SiteGround to host your website. I used different hosts for many, many years, and I dealt with so many problems. Terrible support, slow loading speeds, all sorts of attacks on my site that I couldn't deal with. But when I switched to SiteGround, my problems have gone away. I haven't had to worry about my site once in the 5 years that I've been using SiteGround. And right now you can get 80% off hosting and a free transfer of your website. Hosting can start from as low as $2.99 a month. $2.99 a month. That's so cheap and it's so good. I wouldn't recommend it to you if I didn't use it myself. Head over to nerdyphotographer.com/recommends/SiteGround. That's nerdyphotographer.com/recommends/SiteGround. Or you can click on the link in the episode notes and get over there. 80% off hosting and a free transfer. You're not going to regret it.
Hey, hey, hey. And now for my favorite part of the show. What's that say? Useless information. This is always death.
It's a good place to wrap up. So our useless information for this episode, which I thought was, I wanted to find something fitting to the Black Astronaut theme. The country of Russia has more land area than the planet Pluto.
Wow. Wow.
When you think about the size of an entire planet.
Wow. That's interesting. That's kind of mind blowing. Especially since I've spent so much random time in Russia.
Really? Seriously?
On only on layovers though. Never I never left the airport. But I used to, when I was traveling a lot, they have a big layover place for like international flights. So I would spend several times I've spent like over 12 hours just sitting in the airport in Russia. So that was always an interesting experience. So yeah, wow, that's a mind blow. Like I can't really
think of an entire planet fitting inside of that area.
Yeah, that puts it in perspective. Sometimes that helps actually, because when I look at a planet, I don't know what that is. Like in terms of how the size, yeah, I don't know what that means, you know. So that brings it down to earth to me.
Literally.
A bit. Yeah, like I like that actually. That's cool. Well,
Kamal, thank you so much for being on the show. I'm going to include the link to the book in the episode notes. Anybody who wants to check out the book, but where can people find you online on the interwebs and,
you know, socials? Social media is definitely the easiest. So I am Kamal X. That's my Instagram name. Kamal is spelled K-A-M-A-L and just the letter X. My website is also the same. It's iamkamalx.com. Feel free to reach out to me. I'm any like advice. If you have questions, I'm a completely just an open person. I really do believe that we are in this together. So community is very important to me. So please feel free to send a line or follow or share your work or something you're working on, or just support the vibe. Honestly, like I appreciate any and all of it. Honestly, the book is out now. I'm really proud of it. I think it's a great opportunity to reflect and have dialogue and think about how we move forward as individuals and as a humanity. And, you know, any support in that direction would mean the world to me.
Awesome. I mean, I honestly, the images are very powerful. I got a lot. I mean, just, I haven't seen the whole thing, but I've seen the previews, the images that I like, for sure, not just like a handful. There were quite a few, I found were really impactful, and I think you should be proud of it. Kamal, again, you're welcome to come back anytime. You want to talk about something? It doesn't have to be a book.
For sure.
You're welcome to
come back. For sure. I love it. This was a great conversation. I appreciate it. This is awesome. Thank you so much, man.
Welcome back. Golden and I return from our exploration of the planet's surface, and I hope you enjoyed my talk with Kamal X. be sure to go follow him on social media and check out his book, Black Astronaut. You can find all of those links in the episode notes. And be sure to subscribe to Nerdy Photographer Podcast, leave reviews, and follow along with the Nerdy Photographer on social media. You can find us on TikTok, Instagram, Threads, and X, formerly known as Twitter, at the handle @TheNerdyPhoto. That's @TheNerdyPhoto. So, Golden, do you think our mission was a success?
Snug.
Yeah, but I mean, besides the snacks. Okay, until next time, everybody, stay safe and stay nerdy.
Listen.